So we kind of got to get the structure of this problem down. So we've got middleman dealers, right? So we've got distributors, and we're using retailers to help distribute the product. Their large customers are saying, hey, I want to cut out the middleman and save some money and work with you directly. Right? That hasn't been their business model. They normally just worked exclusively through distributors, like some companies do. They don't want to deal with customers. Customers can be a pain in the butt, right? You got customer service department, all that type of stuff. So they're choosing not to, but they're like, oh, this is kind of tempting because these large distributors already know our product and whatnot. So, but here's the problem. They might lose their distributors and their small customers if they did. There's a lower probability of losing dealers because they would have to incur the cost to change suppliers. That's the large ones. But this would have a larger impact on profit. So you kind of see the case how we got some uncertainty, like should I change my business model, my business plan, and try to appease this group? If I appease this group, I might tick off this group and I might lose some money. So they're really facing some issues here. So how do we handle that in a profit maximization setup? Where in the past, we've got our single product firm, and we've got marginal costs that are upward sloping due to the law of diminishing marginal product, right, or marginal returns. So that creates the law of increasing costs, meaning that each additional unit is going to keep getting more and more costly for us. And depending on the market, we could have marginal revenue changing too if demand is downward sloping. If we're in a competitive market, we can pretty much sell each additional unit at the market price, so we don't have a lot of pricing power. And so where marginal revenue equaled marginal cost was kind of the holy grail of business. So I'm going to maximize profits by producing the quantity where the revenue generated by the last unit is equal to the cost of the last unit. Right? So that quantity of 100 units or whatever it is was the quantity that maximized profits. And then we kind of massage that in a variety of different ways. Well, now, what happens when we don't know how much quantity we're going to have, right? If we make this change, this is a little more realistic in the real world, that we're dealing with uncertainty. How do we handle unknown events? What do you think we need to do in the boardroom here? Imagine you're sitting in the boardroom with the CEO and the CFO and the vice presidents and some other people from marketing, and this is what you're grappling over. What would you want to do?
See how risk averse we are.
Okay.
Because otherwise we'd probably just go with the lowest probability for just trying.
Okay, so when you brought up probability, we need to probably start to assess what those probabilities are.
Right.
So we have a lower probability, but what does that mean? 60%, 20%, 30%, right? So if we have some other numbers, we want to try to kind of work that in.
Yeah, but in the real world, wouldn't they just talk to the distributors?
In order to get that probability, yes. But are we going to get a straight answer from all of them? You know?
Why would that be in their interest not to say if they leave us?
Well, they might be bluffing.
Oh, we get a better price or something?
Of course. Okay. Yeah. You know, you just don't know. There's going to be some level of uncertainty, but you're right. You're going to try to get as much information as possible. So part of this is information gathering. And so the rational actor paradigm would say, let's gather as much information as possible. But even once we have full information, we probably have to deal with some uncertainty. And so that's what this chapter is going to really bring up is what. How do we deal with that uncertainty? Okay, so here's how we deal with it mathematically. So doesn't this look like fun? So a binomial random variable X can have two values, two states of nature, if you will, in the future, time period one, if this is time period zero. It could take on the value x1 or it could take on the value x2, but we don't know which one it's going to be. Right? So it's got probabilities p and 1 minus p, since there's only two. So if you think the probability of x1 is 10% or 0.1, then what's the probability of x2 happening? 90%, right? So that's not, that's why we use that 1 minus p thing here. So don't be scared off too much on that. That's just probabilities. And it brings up an important point that if we're doing this, what do all probabilities of multiple events have to sum to? What? Yeah, so we got to figure out, you know, if there's 3 things, 4 things, 6 things, whatever, those probabilities that we assess have to sum up to 1. Okay, so there's our expected value formula. So that's an important one. What is the expected, let's see, what, if we have a enrollment, let's talk Ottawa University back in April. They always play this game and they usually play it wrong. They usually have rose-colored glasses and are too optimistic on the number of students that we're expecting to get. That aside, let's kind of play this game. So let's just say that on fall enrollment, each student is worth, let's say, $20,000 for the year if they come. You can imagine another thing you guys do with some of your sports is the probability that you'll get an athlete to come with a certain offer. Do I offer them a $10,000 scholarship or do I get away with offering them 7? Right? So what are they willing to take? We're going to gather as much information as possible, but you face some uncertainty with that. So with fall enrollment of $20,000 per person, and if we have campus enrollment of 700, that would be good. But 750 would look even better. And let's just say that that's at 20,000. So we have 2 unknown outcomes here. $20,000 times 700 students or $20,000 times 750 students. So we could look at that incrementally if we wanted. And so what is our expected tuition for fall on April? Well, which one has a higher probability? The 700 most likely, right? So we have, let's say we've got an 80% chance of getting the 20,000 times 700. Somebody want to help me out here on what is that, 1.4 million? The number of zeros we got. We got 0, we got 1. 14 million, thank you. All right, so 14 mil plus a 20% chance at getting, we got 75.
15 million.
15 million. So, what is our expected fall tuition number? Can't tell, I'm making this up as I go, so you guys are relying on you guys to come up with the answer here. And we can break it into parts. What was 80% of 14 million? We got 1.4, 2.8, 11.2? Yeah. 11.2 million plus 20% of 15 million is 3 million?
Yeah.
So I've got an expected value of 14.2 million. That's my expected revenues this fall based on whether I get 750 or 700. And that's if we knew that enrollment. In reality, we might not know if we're going to be 735 or whatever. But given our budgeting now, that makes a difference. If we go with 14, or do I have that extra 14.2? Do I have that extra 15, that extra million? So here's what I learned from Ottawa. There's a little bit of human nature. I'm not trying to beat up on Ottawa too much because I've been prone to have this over time. Is guess what number we use for budgeting?
The high one,
the 15 million. So we started like, oh yeah, we'll probably be at 750. And we start making our budgets. But yeah, there's a 20% chance, maybe it's a 30%, maybe it's 40%. But look at what this does to our budgeting back in April when we're thinking about the fall, is that we've really taken a pretty good chunk out of that. We can maintain our rose-colored glasses, but maybe for budgeting purposes, maybe we should budget 14.2, right? And use that as the number that we work our expenses around. Okay, but that, again, doesn't tend to happen to us. So the important thing is, remember, in reality, we're not gonna get 14.2. That is just our forecast. If we get 750, we'll have 15 mil. If we have 700, we'll get 14 mil. But if we only get 700, we've only got a $200,000 shortfall to figure out. Whereas if we use the rose-colored glasses, we got to trim the budget $1 million, right? It's a little bit more difficult to do. So this can be kind of a helpful way to think about that and get people thinking about how much to weight the money in that scenario. Okay, questions or comments there? So with three numbers again, you just have the three probabilities. So they got it set up here with P1, P2, and then 1 minus P1, P2. So there, you can always figure out the last one. There's four variables, and then it would be X1, X2, X3, and 1 minus the sum of those. Okay, good. So let's see if we can calculate it for our distributor. So if Teleswitch sells only through dealers, suppose that they calculated the probability of losing large customers as 0.6. So they got a 60% chance of losing the large customers. If they sell directly to the large customers, the probability of losing the dealer distributors is 0.2, or 20% chance of losing our distributors. So what is our expected profit? So I'd like you to work on a piece of paper, those of you with your laptops. I think it's really good for you mentally to take a piece of paper and work this out. So here's the profits. If the distributors leave, there's 30 bucks. If the distributors stay, there's 130. If the large customers leave, there's 100. And if the large customers stay, there's 130. So what is the expected profit for each? Selling directly to large customers and selling directly, or selling only to the dealers. Yeah, you can pull out your phone, put on airplane mode if you want to use a calculator. How is the screen looking tonight? Is it hard to read? Let me try to bring this one up. Can you read that one now? Let me try the front camera just out of curiosity. I thought the back camera's higher resolution, but. About same? This is one of the smaller print ones too. So you guys, these PowerPoints are on, I think they're on the Excel, so you guys could have these ahead of time too to look at. I have them modified slightly, but. see you have something on your papers here. Okay, good, good. Yeah, I think it's best to lay out the formula like I did with the tuition example. Just to write it out exactly like that. Let's start with the probability on each one. So follow the tree down, or start with the large customers. So you got a 20% chance of getting a 30 to profit and an 80% chance of getting 130. Okay, so you did it down there, yeah. Lay out the formula. It's good for just recognition later too, on being able to lay out the formula that way. Okay, it looked like most of you are on the right track here. So 20% chance of getting a $30 profit, 80% chance of getting 130, do the math, should get 110. And 112 for the dealers. So what do we do? Sell for the dealers. 112 is greater than 110. Now, that's having some faith in what's driving that answer. The probabilities. Is $2 enough?
Is it millions?
So you're saying no. Why do you say no?
It can go both ways.
Okay. So what you're really touching on is how certain are we of these probabilities? I mean, if these probabilities are super tight with very little error, like they're like, well, it might be 0.6 or 0.60, or it might be 0.600003. Or it might be 0.0003 the other direction, but like we're really tight on this, right? We've done, in some cases, you might have enough repetition, but this is more in the physical world. I'm just trying to kind of push your brains here, right? Like if you take the number of times, like what engineers deal with, like what's the variability that my machine is always going to hole punch? Right? What's the probability that that machine, when it does 1,000 repetitions of like that hole's always going to be in the exact spot where the snap is going to be for the jacket, right? So that the hole is always going to be right in that exact spot. What's the tolerance, right? And so with those types of deals, you can have a pretty tight probability. Like there's a 60% chance, it means like it's probably, you know, they're dealing more like with a 99.994 probability that's going to be, if it's really precision machinery, then they're going to be dealing with those sorts of tolerances. When we're dealing with human beings, how precise are we? Not so precise, right? So we got to be really careful when we're dealing with human beings. That, frankly, that's where the field of economics, I think, went wrong for a large number of years and still goes wrong today in some of our thinking, is that we kind of take what we can calculate mathematically and say, oh, the world's going to work this way, I predict it's going to look like this, not being able to really understand all the uncertainty and unknowns that are there to really make such a claim with bold precision. So how much would it take to send this thing off the rails? So I want you to calculate for me what makes this be 110. There's a couple different ways. You can do a little trial and error if you want. What makes us lose $2? Right? Which one are we gonna have to make bigger? Which one's going to have to get bigger, the 60 or the 40? Which one's going to have to get bigger, a higher chance of getting 100 or a higher chance of getting the 130? The 100, right? So that's going to bring the average down. So now you can start playing little games here of, well, what if this was 0.62 and that was 0.38? Right? Maybe you can solve this out algebraically, but I just want to kind of get you thinking, What makes this 110? What do we have to get up to? You can all just kind of do a little trial and error with your calculator or whatever. First person gets an answer, just kind of shout it out, and we'll just kind of compare notes. I don't have this prepared ahead of time. 67. So if this was 67, and then we plus 7 over here, then we're going to say this is third down to 33. Okay? So 67, 33, and does that end up being 110? Pretty close. Okay. So you can do that type of thing, right? So now, but now here's what's helpful is, when you're sitting in the boardroom talking with the other executives, you can kind of do that type of analysis, right? You can say, you know, let's face it, people, this 60-40 thing, you know, we're feeling pretty good about it. But if it was 67, it would turn this. Or if it was 70-30, this is what the number would be. So how confident are we with 60-40? Right? And so everybody says, well, I'm pretty confident. Well, I'm not so confident. I think it could be me. Whatever. You end up having this discussion about the probabilities and hopefully come to a consensus or at least some sort of majority vote. Maybe the CFO or the CEO has the final trump card, like, well, I don't give a damn. We're going for this because I say so and I'm the boss. Right? They might do that. But your job is to kind of bring up the realm of reasonableness, right? And kind of have a range of what that might be. Okay, so any last questions or comments there? All right, so again, I can't emphasize, I'll probably do this multiple times, but at the end of the day, we're not gonna earn 112. That's what's so bizarre about using this expected value stuff. We're going to make a decision today. We're going to make a decision in April, making a move of some sort, like setting our expense budgets, right? We're going to make a move today based on this calculation. But what's really going to happen, if we go this way, what are profits going to be? $130 or $100, right? It's going to be one or the other. So, and again, maybe kind of similar to our tuition, if we're somewhere in between at 730 or 740 or something else, we might be somewhere in between. But there's only going to be one outcome, and it's very unlikely that it's going to be 112. But yet, that's what we're making our decision on. That's what's kind of mind-bending a little bit on using this technique to make decisions and estimate probabilities. And that's why a lot of people, their brains don't go there, and that's what should distinguish you as an MBA student coming from Ottawa University, that you can bring that type of thing to the table. Like, hey, let's think about it this way. What we'll see later, this game tree type of, this is different than what we did with the game theory, but it's similar when we start putting these probabilities. It's a really helpful way to kind of organize your thinking to think, okay, the probability of this will be the outcome, or this, and just kind of set things up in your mind that way. Okay. So, uncertainty in pricing. So, with demand, we can put people into different types. So, in that other chapter with price discrimination, we had high-value customers and low-value customers. So high-value customers are willing to pay $8. Low-value customers are willing to pay $5. If there's equal numbers in each group, what should we do with our pricing if our cost is 3? Price high or do we price low? So we're making a few assumptions here. We say we think that there's equal numbers of high value and low value customers. We think the high value people can pay 8, low value 5.
Price 5. Five, why? Because then you get all the low value customers along with the high value.
If we price it at five, the high value customers are going to buy it, right? Because they value it at eight, so they're gonna buy it. So we'll get 100% of the market that way. And then we'll be making how much? Two. So we'll make two on each. Okay, what do you think? Everybody agree with Drew?
I think it makes sense because it's above your marginal cost.
Okay, it's above our marginal cost, but what are we out to do? Maximize profit. So we want to make as much money as possible. So if it's possible to get it higher than that, we want to do it.
I mean, there'd be 0.3 one price at 12 below value customers. You have to know how many of each customer you have.
Okay.
It makes sense because there's equal in each, though. Now I see what you're saying.
Yeah. So like we could even think, if you wanted to do it this way, we could think of it as like, suppose there's 100 customers, right? So suppose there's 100 customers. Suppose there's customers equal to 100, and there's half in each. So what would be our profits? What's the profit equation?
Cost or total revenue.
Total revenue, price times quantity minus total cost, which in this case, if our marginal cost, if we're looking at marginal cost pricing, marginal cost times quantity, right? So we kind of got this markup idea that we've been working on, price minus marginal cost times quantity. Okay. And so let's run through each scenario. So the Drew recommendation, the Drew price of $5. What do we get?
$2.50.
So 5 minus our marginal cost of 3 times 50. 100 is the high value people are going to buy it too.
Oh,
right? So we earn 5 minus 3 is 2 times 100 is 200. And then if we do a higher price of $8, we get 8 minus 3 times 50. Ooh, which do we like better?
250.
So price it high. Because there's enough difference here between the high value and low value customers, that works out pretty well. And if we're actually dealing with a marginal cost curve that's upward sloping rather than constant, if we cut our production in half, there's a good chance our costs are actually going to go down. If we were facing an upward sloping marginal cost curve, which is the more realistic case. All right, questions on that? So we can do this in kind of the percentage time. So I chose doing 100 customers, because that's one way to do it. And then if we look at the average per customer, if we've got 100 customers, it's 2 or 250 ends up being the average price collected. So we could, when it's normalized to one, with how we did this, it's really just simply saying, well, suppose there's one customer and half of them, there's my 50, half of them and half of them, this would be half plus a half. So we can kind of work out the equation and get the same answer here. So we're going to pick up, if we price it low, we get half of the customers with two, and we get the low value and the high value, giving us two. Or if we price it high, the low value customers are gonzo, and we just get the $5 markup, 8 minus 3 times the 0.50. And so that all maps out the same way we just did.
So that would all super change if it wasn't 50-50.
Right. I mean, yeah, I mean, you're right, but it wouldn't super change, but it would shift this around. So if we did have, let's say 25 in the high, right, then this would change to 25 customers times 5. 25 times 5 is 125 versus this answer of 200. And it would be better to price low. Okay, any other questions or comments on that?
So not only does it depend on the price, it depends on the amount of customers that would.
Yes. So remember, what we're kind of playing with, let me get rid of this. We're really just highlighting the demand curve. So we're saying, if we go back to the demand curve, there's 50 customers and there's 100 customers. And so we're saying there's 50 people out there willing to pay 8, and there's 100 customers willing to pay 5. So at a price of 5, I pick up an extra 50 customers, right? The low value customers is who I'm really picking up. So if our demand curve looks like that, if I just have these two prices, I drop the price and I pick up the extra low value customers. The high value customers are to the left. So on a demand curve, people are ranked from the most willing to pay to the least willing to pay. And that was our demand curve concept. It's all coming together. All right, any other questions or comments? Yeah.
So not exactly, we just did the we have, you know, put it up like 100 customers.
Yeah.
Even if you said 2 customers, you'd still go with pricing at the high, it's still the same ratio.
I see what you're saying. 2 yeah. and 1 and 1. Yeah. It would all work out the same.
So it didn't really matter how many customers.
No. Okay. Yeah. And that's why the book used this.
Yes.
Is that you kind of normalized your population to 1, and then you can kind of deal like 50-50, right? So that, and just like what was brought up with the, if this was 25-75 or something,
yeah,
the numbers, the average price would just change accordingly. Yep. Okay, good. Anything else on this slide? Okay, so price discrimination. When buying a new car, salespeople discriminate between high and low value customers. How do they do this? So car sales, new and used. So new car, so brand new. Salespeople discriminate between a high value and a low value customer. Okay, they ask them questions. Okay, so that could be one thing. The way you dress, yes.
Your previous car, so like your trade-in.
Yeah, what did you pull up in, right? Did you pull up in an older beat-up car, or did you pull up in a nicer, newer, two-year-old model car or something, and you're ready to trade up again, and you come in with ice dangling all over, and, you know, a gold watch and a gold tooth and a whatever, right? So the salespeople are going to try to use what they have in front of them. They're going to ask questions. Well, how much money do you make? Now, they'll probably be a little timid about how much money do you make. That's usually, people might be offended if they do that. I learned to do that. Once I built up a little bit of trust with real estate, it's like the normal question you get into right away. So I haven't been too bashful on that over time. But for a car salesman, that's not going to happen. So what might they ask you instead of how much money do you make? How much you want to put down? That would be a good one.
What are you looking to spend?
Okay, what are you looking to spend? But what about more income related, like a close question, instead of how much money do you make or what's your income per year? What do you do? Isn't that a nice thing? Don't we all say that cocktail party at the reception. Oh, my name's Russ. Oh, that's great. What do you do? Right? Normal question. What do you do? But that salesman doesn't give a damn what you do. They want to know how much money you make. So if you tell them that you're a real estate developer or something, or you say, well, I work at Wendy's part-time, you know, that's a, whatever, that kind of immediately, just by what they do, might be able to reveal that. Not perfectly, but might be able to kind of do that. So they'll continue on with their quizzing questions and hopefully try to be as unoffensive as possible. Okay, so price discrimination taught us that you identify the two types and then you price each group, right? So you're going to kind of think already on how we might be able to bump up prices to earn a bit more. So with this example, is there a way we could sell the product to the high value customers at 8 and the low value customers at 5? You immediately start to see the benefit, right? Because now I'm going to capture all of these guys, and how much money am I going to make now? Well, I'm going to make 50 people are going to bring me in the $2. So 50 people are going to bring in the $2, 2 times 50, plus the 8 buck people, 50 people are going to bring me in $5. So $5 times 50. And so what do we get here? 100 and what's that big number? 250, $350. Right? So that's 350 versus 250 or 200. If we can price discriminate. Look at what we're doing here. We're capturing this rectangle. The height of this rectangle minus our cost, that's the revenue, that's the price. We've got our $3 cost, so there's our marginal cost. So for this rectangle is what I'm capturing for the high value people, and then for the low value people, I'm picking up this additional amount. 5 minus 3 is 2, times the 50 is the area of that rectangle. 8 minus 3 is 5 times the high value people. Those two rectangles equals $350. Whereas if I only can do the one price without price discrimination, I have this rectangle. 2 times 100 is 200. And if I just do these people, then I get 50 times 5 is 250. So that kind of connects our demand curve concept with consumer surplus and price discrimination. Okay. Comments or questions on that? We only got 2 weeks left. We're bringing it all together. So if a car salesman is doing that type of game, what can you as a customer do to defeat this? Practice. So if the car salesman is asking you those questions and they're trying to peg you in, what can you do to offset that? Not answer them or lie, but I don't like to lie. Don't lie, imply. It's my Russ McCullough's virtue of negotiating. Don't lie, imply. So what do you wear that day to the dealership? Grubby stuff. What car do you drive? Your son's beater car for college, right? You've got your other nice car parked in the garage, drive the beater, right? So you can kind of change how that person's going to eyeball you, and maybe then you can defeat the price discrimination you're going to face. This is all I got. I'm a low-value customer. So my general policy is I don't go garage sailing with my Jag. I always take my truck, right? So I take the old truck so that I can negotiate real good on that $2 shirt. I can talk them down to a buck or a buck 50. That's what I do when I go garage sailing on Saturday mornings.
When I was reading the textbook, it said something about when you go to a car dealership as a woman or as a minority, you always get the higher offer, like the price. But if you're a white male, you always get the lower offer. Mm-hmm. Like how they stay longer.
Yeah, so they've been, yeah, there's been different types of studies that they've done. Same thing with the mechanics, that there's been studies undercover and otherwise on the bill that females get at the mechanics place versus men. And it's been the same type of thing.
I was going to say the same kind of goes for when you go out of the country. I don't know if you noticed it while you're in South Africa. If Dr. Edge was to go to like a shop on the corner of the street, they're going to get lowballed in them extremely. But then if you go, they're going to give you probably twice the amount of what asked for, twice the amount that they asked.
Yeah, and then, that's right. Yep. So we usually try to send the locals up to do the negotiating. However, I will share with you a little story because it was funny for me. So I get done with this safari thing, which is super cool. And they have all of the normal tourist stuff with the little wooden figurines and statues of different things. So there was only one animal I didn't see of the big five. I got super lucky and saw four animals of the five. The one that was missing was the buffalo. So I went in there, I thought, oh, that'd be kind of fun. I'll buy this little water buffalo as a reminder of the one that we didn't see out of the five. So I go in there and negotiate a little bit on that. That's fine. And then I walk around and there's giraffes that I thought might be nice little gifts, and so I negotiated on that. So then I'm leaving, and this guy comes up to me and he says, I make you a good price, right? It's always, that's usually how the conversation starts. So he's got this elephant that's this big, all wood carved, kind of cool looking, but I didn't want it. And you know, just how heavy it is, it's solid wood, it's this big. So it's got some weight to it. You know, we have limits on the carry-on, on how we're going to pack it, whatever. So, of course, the economist me, I couldn't resist. I said, well, how much? He says, 450. So this is 450 grand, which is, the exchange rate was 13, 14 to 1, basically 13 and a half to 1. So, whatever, 35 bucks or something like that. So, I said, I really don't want it. I was just curious. He's like, maybe not. And I told him, you're not going to want to hear my offer. And he's like, oh, come on, make me an offer. I said, 200. So it's at 450, I said 200. I usually don't negotiate that low, just so you know. My general policy is if I want to buy it, it would be above, I recommend usually 60 to 70% of the asking price when you're really trying to negotiate. Of course, in different cultures and different countries, that's kind of almost off the table, but that's kind of American negotiations. But I really didn't want it, so I said 200. So then he says, how about 375? And I said, 200. And then he's like, give me your best price. I'm like, I gave you my best price. I don't really want it. And so we kind of, you know, just had a standstill there, and I was like, fine, I'll, you know, no big deal. He's like, can you do 250? I said 200. He said 230. I said 200. And he took 200. I have the elephant in my living room. So I was like, and I wasn't trying to be an American jerk or take advantage of him. I didn't really want the elephant, but I committed to 200, and I'm like, okay, I'll pay the 200 if he goes to 200. He went to 200, and he wrapped it up. So I bought it for less than half. And it's pretty cool. I'm glad, and now I have that story to tell for a long time. But it reminded me of a not so clean film of Bad Santa. Anybody see that movie where he's negotiating with the 50-year? The two thieves are trying to negotiate the slit of the tape, and he's like 50. And it was the same type of thing where the one guy's trying to negotiate him down, and he kept saying 50 the whole time, and then finally that's where they ended up. So, all right. So yeah, fun. Okay. So there are different strategies we can do. I'll let you read this. minimizing the error, expected error. Like, what if we make a mistake? Let's try to make the smallest mistake possible. It's kind of a logic with this one. So, is global warming for real? Do we have hardcore, scientific, undisputable evidence that it is absolutely man-made and that the planet doesn't go through some sort of cycles on its own? So I think, you know, there is actually science on both sides of that. Despite what some of the school system teaches, is there global warming? There's global temperatures that change. I almost kind of laughed when I went to Lawrence and, you know, they're going through the thousands, you know, 40,000, 40 million years ago, whatever, you know, with the Earth. You guys are seeing that type of stuff. And it's like, well, crap, the Earth's been changing for millions of years. Why wouldn't we expect it to be changing now, right? I mean, it's the ice age, the whole thing. I mean, it's been cold, it's been hot, you know, it's changed all the time. So, you know, that kind of dawned on me when I went and visited that thing. I thought, oh, geez, that's kind of obvious. But, so is it the human activity, you know, climate, human cause climate? So there's a little bit of uncertainty with that. So that's what this problem's trying to tease out. So if it's caused by human activity, then a carbon tax might help reduce it. But if global warming's not so much human, or it's a very small probability, right? Like humans are causing some little fractional amount or something. Well, then if we put a tax on that stuff, we're really missing out on a lot of opportunities, right? So then all of a sudden coal doesn't look so bad if it's not causing a big, great deal of pollution. And our energy costs would be so much less if we can use fossil fuels, right? That's all it's trying to play up, is that there's this uncertainty here that we need to look at. And so one way to tackle that would be to look at the probability and the cost associated with each. So it highlights these two types of errors, a type one error and a type two error. So a type one error is we implement a tax and it's not caused by human activity. Or a type two, we don't do it and we actually do cause global warming. See the difference there? So it's like, what type of error are we making? There's kind of an uncertain outcome either way. We're facing uncertainty either way. A lot of times people will say, oh, well, we should just do what's good for the environment always, as if there's no cost. So people, again, don't do a cost-benefit analysis of it. And that's where this stuff, dealing with uncertainty, can help us do maybe a little bit better cost-benefit, because there is a cost to imposing taxes or reducing activities that may not end up being harmful. So then the probability setup. So we do a carbon tax, and global warming is caused by human activity. Then that turned out to be a pretty good deal. Otherwise, if global warming is not caused by human activity, we have a cost of imposing that tax. And so here, global warming is caused by human activity, but we don't tax it, then the Earth burns up into a fiery furnace of hell 200 years from now, right? And that's the cost times the probability of that cost happening. So that is one way to do it, and then we just take the smaller of the two. And that's the optimal decision. So we're going to say, what would be the least costly thing, thinking about those probabilities? So, airlines, hotels, cruise ships, we've kind of talked about that before. What do you think the author's hinting at here? Over, under. This type of analysis is especially useful. The risk associated with errors of over versus under. What's going on there? Hotels, cruise ships.
Overbooking versus pricing too high that they have seats or cruise.
Yes, good. So kind of that capacity issue, right? So I'm going to have to commit to either building a bigger ship or a smaller ship. I'm not really perfectly sure of whether I'm going to fill the big ship or not, but I might be making a big mistake, because if the demand is high, I can fill the 600-bed cruise ship. Right? If the demand is high, I'm going to make more money by doing a 600 cruise ship. But if the demand turns out to be low, and it's only 400, and I have 200 empty beds, then that's going to have a cost associated of the empty beds. So either I'm going to be making the smaller 400-person ship and missing out on 200 more beds that I could have done, the high-value customers, and I could have made more money or something off of that larger ship, or I make the big ship and the demand's not there, and I have empty rooms and that costs me. So what would be worse? Is it worse? So back to this type of analysis for that, how much money am I going to lose in either case? Is it better to build the big ship and have demand short, or is it better to build a small ship and miss out on the big demand, right? And then you kind of do your analysis from that. All right, questions or comments there? Yeah?
Is this kind of like launching products where you're deciding whether to launch, and if you launch it, it's not profitable, or if you don't launch it, it might be profitable?
Yeah, yep, it would work for something like that too. Yep, for sure. Yeah, because you're trying to say, is this a go? If we decide to launch it, we're going to have a whole bunch of upfront money to get it launched, right? And so that money will kind of go to waste if we do it. If we don't launch, then we're missing out on the profit. Like, this might be the latest, greatest thing or whatever. The demand might be high, and we could have made an oodles of money on this. So Coca-Cola wondering if it should launch a new product line or new Coke, that kind of bomb, right? So you guys don't know the history. Coca-Cola tried a new formula back in the 90s or something. Maybe it was even the 80s. Yeah, it was the 80s. So, you know, should we launch it, should we not? And then kind of looking at the costs associated with each. Okay, anything else? Okay, so we've kind of highlighted a couple different topics. Risk and uncertainty. So this is an important way to think about this. We can characterize uncertainty about variables that change. So we can do the expected profit thing. Uncertainty is uncertainty about the distribution of the random variables, which probabilities should be assigned to the values. So remember when we did the 60-40 thing? Is it really possible to be 60-40, or would somebody in that boardroom say, I don't think it's 60-40, I think it's 10-90. Oh, really, George? Well, I think it's 50-50. Oh, really, Sally? I think it's 95-5, right? And so we're like all over the board on what the percentage is. What does that mean? You're facing some true uncertainty. And you can't do that calculation. We saw how that calculation is meaningless if you can't put at least a decent range on the probabilities, then that analysis becomes kind of meaningless, right? So that's what we want to think about here, is what is the distribution of the random variables? How tall is the tail? Do you guys remember the normal distribution? The bell curve? What was at the top of the bell? It's not necessarily it's not an outlier. So what's down
the error? The standard deviation of the error?
You're getting close. Standard deviation has something to do with the width of this bell. What'd you say? The mean. Yeah, it would be the mean or the predicted value. Yes. So here is like the most probable outcome. So I think it's going to be this value, X1, with an 80% chance, right? And now if this bell is really tight, it's like, well, I might be wrong. It could be X2, but if it's X2, we're not going to be very off by very far, right? So this distance here gets into your standard deviation, and the tails of the distribution, if this is a 5% or 2.5% on this tail and 2.5% on this tail, then 95% of the observations are within two standard deviations of the mean.
And then the 2.5 would be the error term, right?
Yes, yeah, okay. That would be the error. So that would be outside your confidence interval. So that was just kind of tying it back to some other concepts. So if this distribution instead looks like your little mountain here looks like this, which one has more certainty, the blue one or the orange one? The blue, right? It has a tighter range. That's what we're talking about. The more flat this becomes, the less you really know about the probabilities. It's like, well, geez, Sally, it could be 80, but it could be 10. With there's an equal probability it could be 10% or 20%. Or John thinks it could be, you know, 95 or whatever. So the flattening of the bell means there's more variance, there's more variability in the unknown variable we're looking at. Okay, so guess where we can have an insurance market?
Anywhere with
uncertainty or risk?
Oh, with risk.
Risk, right? So risk, we know that there's going to be an unknown outcome, and so that can be priced. And so this is going to bring us into insurance issues here as we get into the next chapter. But the insurance is a market that can then be priced, whereas uncertainty doesn't have a market. So you don't have an insurance market for something that faces a distribution like this. It's like, sorry, I don't want to touch that. You might as well go to Vegas, right? So you've got an equal probability of hitting the roulette wheel. That's called gambling. So this is gambling, whereas this, when the probabilities are fairly certain of different outcomes, now you can price it, and there'll be a market for it.
That's why I have a lot of points on the back of the risk obviously is higher, so the pricing.
Yeah, yep, and so yeah, the pricing of insurance, stuff like that, whether you're male or female, whether you get good grades or not, they're just putting you into a category because they've learned over time that people with good grades are less risky, and so then they can be competitive with other insurance companies by offering a lower price. Then all the students flock to that State Farm insurance, and then the other insurance company is forced to lower their prices for good students. And then some of them flock over here. So in a competitive market, insurance premiums are going to be competitive and priced low and should be close to equal among insurance companies. And if you shop that around, that's what you find. You usually don't get super good deals from one company that's way lower than the other. The case where that cannot be true is where some companies have a better pool of applicants that you'll join into. A bigger pool, or it could be a niche thing, like my wife is into horse lessons, and so there's a pretty good liability insurance of people falling off a horse and getting hurt. And so some of her insurance premiums at like some company that really doesn't deal with horses that much, it was really high. And then she found another company that really specialized in horses, and they get a lot of trainers from all over the nation to be in the horse pool. And then they can more effectively price it. They can outprice the other ones who don't have that same pool to draw. So a lot of different variables like that that we'll get into. Okay, well that looks like a good spot to go ahead into a break. So I've got 7:25, so we'll plan on 20 minutes to.
It's like a 2 gigabyte file.
Okay, I found the bad Santa.
A clip.
That's how you spent your break?
Yeah.
I think there's a little foul language, so those of you who are offended by that,
that's what separates us from the other grads.
Yeah.
It's fine.
Okay, so the midget and Billy Joe, what's his name?
Billy Bob Thorne.
Billy Bob Thorne, and they're the bad guys that are got this heist down, and then he's Bernie Mac's got them figured out, and so they're negotiating a split. So.
Jesus, tell me, while the rest have soon, we won't take a little message from that.
And the other is moral hazard. So we're going to explore both of those. Moral hazard we'll actually do next week. Incidentally, next week is our last week, and I'm thinking if we can squeeze in enough time that maybe around like, oh, I don't want to get exact time, but maybe somewhere between like around 8:30 or so, maybe we head off to a local establishment and have the final lecture at some fine place in town here. Unfortunately, that means our Zoom people won't be able to join, although I could bring my laptop there, but class will be officially ended, but I thought it might be fun. I like to go out with the graduate students, and so that's what I've done in the past. So maybe we could go someplace. Where would be a good place to go? We've gone to the Beach Cove. Well, it's called something different now. Beach Cove or whatever. We've gone there a few times. Whatever. Applebee's, O-Town. Where do you guys hang out now?
Those all sound good.
Home? Where, David?
I said those all sound good.
It'll be your Tuesday, so.
Yeah, where's the Tuesday special?
Oh, Taco Tuesday.
Oh, Taco Tuesday.
Taco Tuesday.
Definitely. Yeah,
Taco Tuesday.
Does that go that way? Yeah, let's do Taco. All right, so we'll go to the Cove. So we'll plan on the Cove. We'll see how the class goes, and then we'll cut a little bit early, so then hopefully we won't be infringing on your other time, and you can come visit. So that means, Jason, you better be to campus next week. So. Okay, so so let's get into some of these issues here. So insurance is the purchase of risk. So you're actually able to sell, buy and sell risk, essentially, is what you're doing. That will kind of probably put a twist on it in a unique way that you haven't thought about it before, on buying and selling risk from each other. So adverse selection comes out of a more general problem that we have in economics called asymmetric information. So, who knows more about yourself when you go to apply for the insurance premium, so life insurance, let's say? Who knows more about the risk involved, you or the insurance company, at first blush, like when you first knock on the agent's door and say, hey, I'm thinking about life insurance. Who knows more about you, you or the insurance company?
You
do, right? So that's the asymmetric information problem. So insurance companies aren't going to price you a quote on just a signature in your name, right? Well, what's your name, what's your social security number? We're not going to run any checks or anything, but that's just what we need to have by law. And you can buy a $400,000 policy for just $50 a month, right? They don't do it that way. Why? Because if you're a person who rides bulls and jumps out of airplanes and does juggling with knives and planes or something, they're going to be running a higher risk than what they would otherwise do. So the price of insurance is intimately related to the risk they're taking on with it. And so they need to reduce that asymmetric information. This is true in all sorts of cases in the marketplace. So what do we find on most food products in the United States? What's something that is shared on that? What?
Nutrition labels.
Nutrition label, right? So we've got the calories. Now, is the calories and everything always in a different spot? You kind of have to hunt around the can. No, it's very standardized, right? It's on that label. It's right there. Now, that was through government regulation. Oh, good. You got the Cheez-It thing. Yes, that would be a good thing to – let me use that as a prop. Get it on camera here. So this is perfect. Okay. So everything's very standardized, right? So I'll hold it up to the camera. This is the one that'll stay live. So everything's there. Why is it there? What would be inefficient about not having it there?
Nobody would know how much they're supposed to eat or what they're eating.
I think that's a bit too strong. Like, you're right, nobody would know. How should I say that? I'm not saying you're wrong, because you're right. The way you said that kind of struck me a little bit differently. Like, how would we know? Like, what would we need to do?
We'll search for it.
Search for it. A little bit of trial and error, maybe, on things, and do a bunch of hunting. So this helps it be more standardized, right, so that it's right there at your fingertips. But also, if you have a cheese allergy, or these things probably have something that you're allergic to, sugar, I guess a little bit of sugar, but whatever. Would you ever buy them if you knew that it had something you're allergic to? No. So the food label helps you not buy it, right? So if we didn't have that, you might buy it and you're like, oh, I think this has, I did my research, or I took a bite of it and I started to get a little reaction. I'm going to throw this in the garbage can. I won't actually throw it since you're cheese inside. And so you see the waste that it created for society if you have people that can't make a good decision. So the lack of information, the Cheez-It seller has more information than you do about the product. And so in economics, we want to squeeze out all of that information to try to level the playing field between the buyer and the seller, which is really kind of counter to what we always think about on how we're going to make money, right? How are you going to make money with stocks? Well, I'm going to learn inside information about that company. I know that they're going to come up with the latest greatest thing. It hasn't hit the media yet. So you have more information than the general public, right? And it gives you an unfair advantage. The price of the stock, if everybody had that information, what would happen to the general price of the stock? It would go up, right? And that's exactly what you're trying to do. But from an economist standpoint, that's not good, that we have an unequal information space. Because as Hayek put it, the magic of the market is through these changing prices of everything, so that we can make decisions of buying one thing relative to another. We're making those choices, and that's gently guiding resources to their highest and best use as we make those decisions through time. And so asymmetric information causes problems when we have one person with more information than the other. Okay. So in the insurance market, that's especially true when you go to the company to get your policy. You know how much smoking you've done over time, and maybe Facebook hasn't recorded all of that yet. And so maybe you'll be able to get a different deal. So to overcome that information difference, we've got two different techniques. Screening is what the uninformed party does. Signaling is what the informed party does. So on a screen, what does the insurance company do? They're the uninformed party, you told me, right? So you're the new applicant, you knock on the agent's door. And so the insurance company or the insurance agent needs to start the screening process. What do they do?
Like a physical.
Okay, yep, you need to get a physical for your health. That's a screen.
And check health records.
Check the records, pull the records, maybe a credit report. Fill out an application, background check, right? So they're going to do all of that stuff. Those are all screens. Now, signaling is a little bit different twist. Sometimes the informed party wants to tell the other party what they're doing. So the example I love to give is very personal because I was actually in this room when I did this, oh my gosh, probably nine plus years ago now. So, can you ask potential applicants what religion they are? Is that fair in a job interview?
No,
it's not, but it turned out. So it's funny, when I interviewed for, when I was going to graduate school for this real estate company, I was just trying to get a property management job at the time to start graduate school in 1993. And I sat down with this guy, and he's kind of interviewing us. And so he says, so what church do you go to?
He asked that.
And I, of course, wanted the job and stuff, so I just played along with it. But so those type of questions can get asked. One might not be a legal question to ask. So here when I was at Ottawa University, as some of you know, we have a Christian heritage, American Baptist. You know, we have atheists and we have people of all faiths or no faith at all here on campus. But me being the negotiator and the economist, I thought, well, maybe it would kind of give me an edge if they knew I was a Christian. So being the clever one, I'm sitting in this room having a little lunch thing, and I just kind of casually brought up a little bit of my background. Well, I was raised Catholic, but I married a Lutheran, so I've been attending the Lutheran church here. And I just said that. Nobody at the table in theory could ask me that like my old employer did, but I signaled to them that I was a Christian, right? So I'm filling them in because they couldn't ask me. So sometimes you can send up a signal to equalize the information if it works to your advantage. Okay, so questions or comments on screening or signaling? Okay. So we've got eBay. How many people are eBay people?
Sometimes.
And I continue to find the good deals. So my son wanted to get a GoPro. So I was just on eBay yesterday while we were getting back from our trip. He's getting a GoPro. And so we found a really good deal with all the attachments and stuff. But I pretty much always check all the secondhand places right away. So whether it's, you know, Craigslist or the Swap and Talk here locally and the eBay, once you get to, depending on the type of item you're looking for. So how do we get that trust factor? Well, eBay's done a lot of efforts to try to solve the asymmetric information problem, right? When they started off, probably long before you guys ever used it, but I was pretty much using it at the beginning, near the beginning. So the whole idea of building a reputation and stuff, that wasn't really well vetted out. They had a buyer and a seller. They were just trying to play matchmaker, kind of. And of course, people were getting screwed on some deals and getting on good on other deals. So slowly but surely, they've continued to add more and more security, essentially, to keep bad people out and good people making exchanges. So All right, escrow services, online reputations, all that stuff is kind of trying to work on this asymmetric information problem. All the stars that we give the restaurants and places that we visit, that's all addressing this asymmetric information problem from an economic standpoint. Okay, comments or questions there? All right, so I think I want to do this one first here. Uncle Melty. So you guys know who Michael Moore is? He's kind of the outspoken, let's see if this will work on a click. Okay, we'll try this. So this is the young Michael Moore. Are you guys familiar with the Ford Pinto? The old Ford Pinto. All right, so they had a little problem with the Ford Pinto exploding on rear end collisions back in the 70s. And so Michael Moore here was apparently in college, and he happened to run into Dr. Friedman up on stage. And so they're going to kind of go through some issues in how the issue was handled by Ford. And so I'll kind of let it play out. I think that's enough background information that hopefully this should make some sense here. So
this has to do with the Ford Pinto. I'm not sure if you're aware of recent revelations that have come out about the production of that car. Ford produced it knowing full well that in any rear-end collision, the gas tank would blow up because they had failed to install a $13 plastic block in front of the gas tank. And Ford estimated in an internal memo that that would cost about 200 lives a year. They estimated further that the cost of each life would be $200,000. They multiplied and they found that the cost of installing those blocks in each of the cars would be more than the cost of saving those 200 lives. And over the past 7 years, the cars have been produced and over 1,000 lives have been lost. It seems to me that Ford did what would be the right thing according to your policy. And yet that seems to me to be very wrong.
Well, let me ask you, let's suppose it would have cost $1 million. You're not arguing about principle.
No.
Because nobody can take the principle. Nobody can accept the principle that an infinite value should be put on an individual line. Because in order to get the money involved, in order to get the resources involved, it's not money. In order to get the resources, they have to come from somewhere. And you want the policy which maximizes the situation overall. You cannot accept the situation that a million people should starve in order to provide one person with a car that is completely safe.
That's absolutely right.
Right. And you're not arguing anything about principle. You're just arguing whether Ford used $200,000 was the right number or not.
No, I'm not arguing.
Suppose it were $200 million.
No.
Suppose it were $200 million, what should Ford have done?
$200 million for what?
Suppose it would have cost $200 million per life sentence. Should Ford still have spent that $200 million?
You mean put? Well, that's not really the question.
Yes, it is a question. That's the only principle involved. I don't know whether Ford did the right thing.
The question
right
is
or not. What's the question of whether these numbers are valid numbers for the relative costs of different things? You're not arguing about a principle. If you want to agree with me, that if it had been $200 million, the cost per life saving for $200 million, you would not argue. Look, let me go back for a moment.
Can I say something in response to that? If Ford had not been able to market those cars in the same kind of economic bracket because of the price of installing this one plastic block, that would be a different question. Maybe Ford could have considered redesigning the whole car so as to make it cheaper. But what we're talking about is balancing advantages and balancing principles. Just a minute. I'm a supporter of abortion. Therefore, I don't believe that every single human life is sacred. I believe that principles have to be balanced. And yet, I don't see Ford spending $13 less on each car at the cost of 200 lives a year as being a principled position to take. And yet, I think
there's one fewer life. So that the $13 per car, so that one life, instead of being 200 times, what's 200 times, 200,000, 40 million. Suppose there had been one life in your 40 million. then it went all kinds of form, not
to protect them. The one life is going to be cost because of the physical defect in the car. This is a clear.
I know, but this is, you're evading the question of principle.
No, I'm not. I'm saying that they knew before they put the car out that there wasn't a mechanical defect.
You know, when you buy a car, you know that your chance of being killed is a window as big as your chance of being killed in a car.
No, I didn't. I didn't know that the gas tank would rupture.
Of course it is a question. Well, every one of us separately in this room could, at a cost, reduce his risk of dying tomorrow. You don't have to walk across the street. Of course. The question is he willing to pay for it? And the question here, he should be raising, is he wants to raise a question of principle. The principle he should raise is whether Ford wasn't required to attach to this car the state. We have made this car $13 cheaper, and therefore it is one, whatever the percentage is, it is 1% more risky for you to buy.
But why?
Now that, then he would be arguing a real question of principle.
Why should they do that? Doesn't that interfere with the free enterprise system that you're touting? Why not?
The consumer should be free to decide what risk you want to pay. If you want to pay $13 extra for that, you should be free to know it. If you don't want to pay $13, excuse me, we have to be one more.
So then the government does have the right to require information for corporations,
No, the government has the right to provide parts of law in which corporations that deliberately conceal material that is relevant to the suit for fraud and may pay very heavy expenses. And that is a desirable part of the market, of course. What I'm trying to say to you is that these things are really a little bit more subtle and sophisticated. And you are the first one to believe there are no you can't get easy answers along this line. Because your way of putting it really only doesn't really get at the fundamental principles. The real fundamental principle is that people individually should be free to decide how much they're willing to pay for reducing the chances of their death. Now people mostly aren't willing to pay very much. I personally regard this as very, very illogical. I see people on all sides of me smoking. Well, there's no doubt, nobody denies that increases their chance of death. I'm not saying they shouldn't be free to smoke, I'm just saying them. I just think they're fools to do. And I know they're fools because I quit on the basis of the evidence 18 years ago. But that's the real issue. And if you want it to be rated for, you want to be rated on those terms, not on the ground that you don't think they use the right one. Now look, I don't think we can keep on going very much. I'm afraid we're going to run out of tape. I'm afraid I'm going to run out of voice. So I think I'll call it again. Thank you.
Okay. Questions on that one? Did you follow the logic? Uncle Melty there. The only question, like I was with him, what was he talking about was the question of principle. Because I feel like I missed a little bit of the premise of that. It was kind of the principle of saving the life versus the monetary disadvantage.
Yeah. So I think basically, young Michael Moore there, by the way, I don't know if that's really Michael Moore. It just looked like him. So I don't remember if I saw it or if I just thought it looked like it. So I don't know for sure if it's the real Michael Moore. But. He was calling into question this decision to say, we estimate $200,000 for life is what we'd have to pay out if we got sued versus the $13 fix. And so they chose not to fix it and to run the risk of that. It turned out that there was 200 lives that were lost because of that. And so the principle that was being argued is he was saying, like, was that something, was that what was wrong or not? Was it wrong in a capitalist system, in the profit system, that this type of calculation would be made? That's the principle he was trying to put on. Any questions or comments, whatever. If you guys have more clarification and thinking about it or comments.
So from a numbers standpoint, it makes sense because they actually saved money by not making the fix, correct?
Yeah, that was the idea. So this would have been $13 for every car made
So 13 for like a recall, right? We hear about the recalls. So they would have had to do 13 times that fix. And then that number was more than the expected number of lives lost times 200,000.
From an economic standpoint, it makes sense. From a moral standpoint, obviously not.
And that's what Milton Friedman is saying. He says even from a moral standpoint, he's arguing that that's the wrong principle.
Wasn't he saying that we risk our, basically we risk our lives every day, so when, like, so we pick the choice, we pick the risk that we're gonna live, because he said, if, like, don't cross the street or something like that.
Right.
Or yeah. How it's, you have a higher risk of dying if you smoke.
Right.
So, like, I think I get what he's saying, as far as, like, you chose your risk by even picking that car.
Good. So that's exactly the angle he was taking. So now, what was the real thing that Ford did wrong? You might not have picked that up out of this, but what did Ford do wrong?
It wasn't common knowledge.
It wasn't common knowledge. The asymmetric information problem was not done. So what happened is they covered up this for a little bit. And so Ford would have been fine in Milton's eyes if they would have just said, hey, the Pinto might blow up on you. Here's the probability of it happening. You've got a 1 in 1 million chance. We thought it was 1/whatever, but it turned out there's a higher chance if there is an accident, so your chance is actually higher. So in his eyes, the principal problem wasn't that we were doing this calculation. It's just that the consumer didn't have the opportunity to say, I'm not going to buy your car, because they didn't know the true risk.
So he was arguing. Had they known the true risk, people would still pay for it because of the odds.
Yeah.
The risk is so low that actually getting into an accident.
Right. And we make those decisions all the time. Like, should I cross the road or should I smoke or whatever, you know, whatever the case is. Yeah, got it. So that's kind of the power of I love that episode because it kind of gets into some details here of why that asymmetric information problem is important. And so if we have equal information on the consumer side as well as the producer side, then the market, everybody's free to choose. So his book, by the way, which I highly recommend, is called Free to Choose. I don't know if that's called Free to Choose is here. So he did a 10-part video series that my economics majors, so Jason and Jacob, we didn't go through all 10 parts, but we went through different parts where he presented some of that stuff, but there's a book called Free to Choose. Did you read that, Jacob, by the way, Free to Choose? Did you take a copy of that?
I don't have it.
I loaned it to you. Okay, we'll talk about that later. I might have lent it out to somebody else. I have it written down. I tried to write it.
No, it's on my list of things.
Yeah, no, and it's a really good book. I enjoyed it.
So the question about it, though, so I get the hard point about, like, the government's being there to establish, like, a rule of law. Property rights.
Yeah.
It's strong.
Oh, is this part that I wrote?
Yeah. But the rules of disclosure is what I was a little confused about, because you made the point about how markets created disclosure laws for companies, which is a good thing because it, you know, makes people safe. But how did markets
create
that? Because there wasn't that a creation of the SEC, which was.
Yeah, so Milton might not agree with all that. So maybe to a certain extent, but for the most part, Milton Friedman wants the government to provide this, so that if a consumer gets screwed, they can go get compensation back. And so what Milton Friedman probably wouldn't agree with as much is forcing the company to do a whole bunch of bureaucracy, a bunch of rules and regulations, and because it's always a, you know, people get this false sense of security that the government's got them back. That's probably safe, when in reality, the companies or other people might find ways around the regulation or whatever, right? And so what ends up happening is government grows over time. The more regulations pile on, oh, well, that was kind of weird. I didn't expect a mass shooting like that. Well, let's do another regulation. Let's do another regulation. Let's change it. And before you know it, your regulations are piled up and you've got something that nobody can really understand or digest anyway. And so what Milton Friedman would say is he wouldn't say no rules. You know, maybe he'd agree with some stuff. I don't want to put words in his mouth because he'd be pretty free market oriented.
Yeah.
He'd just say, make sure these people have a good solid system to get compensation if they're wrong. And so it's more of a buyer beware type of thing where you need to know what you're buying. And if you know what you're buying and there's a risk associated with it, that's what you did. And if something wasn't disclosed to you, then you have the right to be compensated back. So probably the one issue where it becomes life and death, it's like it's hard to sue when you're dead, right? And so then, you know, then you're kind of back to, well, maybe that's an area we should be extra special careful on, that this is a life and death situation. I'll give you an example. I'll come to you in a second. You can hold it. Because, man, Guatemala was freaking awesome. So Drew, you asked how that went. So I jumped off a 30-foot cliff into some water, and I'd never done that high before. I also climbed in a cave that had a river flowing through it where I was holding a candle, and there were spots in the cave, and, you know, I don't speak Spanish, my wife does, but not knowing if you just kind of went in there as a tourist, there's spots where you can't touch, and you're holding onto a rope, and you're kind of climbing around, not being able to touch in the bottom. Sometimes there's submerged rocks, and so at first I started swimming and I cut my toe on it. And then once you get deeper into the cave, you're climbing up a ladder, up underneath, ducking stalagmites, and in this cave and crawling in a precarious positions on slippery rocks. Then we got deep into the body of the cave, and the guide was showing us that we could jump into this pool of water. And so we climbed up the cave wall and we jumped down in the cave. Super cool stuff. But I didn't sign any sort of liability form, right? And so then we go outside. It's the most gorgeous landscape I've ever seen. I've traveled a lot of places. I've been to Hawaii. This was unbelievably gorgeous. And so we're doing these kind of cliff jumps into the water like you see on TV. And so I did the first one, you know, it was 10 foot or whatever. We did this the day before on a different place. And then we get up to this high one, and the guy goes up there and he's like, you know, jump here. So then my son wants to do it. And I'm like, well, if he's doing it, I'm going to do it. And so we climb up the rocks. To get up the rocks, there's just a rope, and you're climbing up these rocks, and no guardrails, no lifeguards, no sign off of liability, no nothing. So I jump off and I smack the bottom. I must not have went far enough to the left, but I'm also heavier than my son. And so I still have a sore on my butt because I jumped in the water and I went down and I slammed hard on a boulder. I'm like, did I just break my hip or leg or, you know, have you been stunned and stuff like that where you're not sure how bad? Jacob, you just had those.
Yeah.
Couple different injuries, so you know what I'm talking about. And so then I'm swimming back, and I'm not sure if I'm just hurt. Well, it turned out I just got like kind of a bad bruise, and you can still feel it. But my point with all that is, who do I sue? Right? It's Guatemala, it's a foreign country. Their court system's kind of messed up. They don't have any money anyway, even if you did. So it's free market, baby, over there. And you need to have a little buyer beware. Like if you don't feel safe jumping off a cliff into the water, don't jump off the freaking cliff, right? Just because everybody else is doing it, which is what I did, I was a little lemming going off the cliff, might not be the thing to do. So kind of interesting. It really highlights when you travel to a country like that, some of the things we take for granted, that we kind of get easy with our minds on what we do. It's like, the government's probably got that figured out. Our trust factor on the podcast that we just did today, our interviewee, Dr. Tony Gill, talked about the moral fabric of trust and how important that is in a market economy. And so part of that trust can come from rules that the government has into place, but sometimes we can put too much faith that the government has it. So another video that I think I'll get to here shortly is like on the financial crisis from 2008 and all the things that we have going on there, where sometimes we naively think the government is monitoring those big bad banks, and they're not. They're not able to monitor it any better than, and possibly worse than how maybe a different system could be of them self-monitoring or some sort of insurance market or some other solution. So a lot of times we have too much faith that somebody's monitoring them and somebody's got it in check when maybe that's not happening. Okay, let me get to your question.
That was actually exactly what I was getting to say. It's crazy how much trust that we just assume that, like, when we buy a car, that everything's okay, like, that, you know, it's safe and that we have so much faith in that because, I don't know if it's, like you said, because of the government regulation that we just assume that we're going to be told all that, or we don't even consider the fact that they're not telling us everything.
It is a combination of both that has evolved over time. I mean, what really happens is people who provide safe products are in business long-term and they make more money. So if they are profit-oriented and not just somehow short-term oriented, like, I'm going to put out a dangerous food product that's going to make a lot of people sick, well, you're not going to be in business very long, right? So that network, that fabric of trust that we've evolved over time with our capitalist system, it's definitely a mixed economy because we do have this in place to where hopefully we can have some retribution if we're wrong with the courts. And in some cases, maybe food safety or other things might be hurting us. So to give you an example that Milton Friedman goes through in one of the videos is with healthcare and the FDA. So we have potentially a new life-saving drug for a chronic illness. Well, that drug has to go through a series of testing because of public safety. We got to make sure the government wants to put on the blessing that that's not going to have some harmful effects while people are dying in the meantime. So over the next 2 years, while the FDA is processing that drug, maybe 30,000 people die because they're not able to take that drug. So should they have the right to be able to take that drug, choose to take that drug, know the chance of death with taking an experimental drug that hasn't been vetted out, should people be free to choose to take that good if they know the risk? That's what our country has been based on historically, was that freedom, individual freedom, you're free to choose, you're free to be dumb, you're free to do stupid things, you're free to hurt yourself if you jump off a cliff into water of unknown depths, right? So you are free to do that stuff. And hopefully we have a court system that would then support that if we don't. But if that company comes up and says, hey, this is a new drug, we think this is what this happens, but we haven't really done a number of trials, you know, do you want to be a guinea pig with this or not? Like the company lays all the probabilities on the table, right? So they kind of, they're not holding back, they're not concealing anything. Should that person have the right to the drug? In the United States, historically, you can't take that drug. And so people die because of our lengthy process under the idea of public safety. Well, we're going to make it safe for the public. Well, you just killed 30,000 people by not doing it, right? Well, you might not have known that in hindsight, but that was an element. You know, these kind of interesting things that pop up as we think through the economic principles. Okay, any other questions or comments there?
Definitely, like, if you use car market, like, you get a better deal if you buy the used car also on Craigslist versus buying that same used car from the dealer.
Yes.
You're getting more, you basically got more knowledge that you're relying more that they've got that car is better, in better condition from the dealer.
That's right. The dealer, and that's due to law also, so there's lemon laws, so there's like, they have to give it back or pay you back if something wasn't right with the car. But from a person-to-person deal, there's no warranties or guarantees, there's no lemon law associated with that. And so yeah, you're much more subject to potentially finding something wrong with the car. Now, I think what usually happens is I kind of go the other way, and you have to be careful, I can't say it's worked perfectly for me, but a lot of times people will trade in a junky car at a dealer because they're like, oh, they're a dealer. I don't have to tell them about the broken this and that and the burning oil and whatever, right? Because the dealer's all going to buy that wholesale anyway. So let them take on the risk. And so then they have to figure it out. I'm not so sure there's not better cars out there if you try to learn the background before you buy the used car on Craigslist. But yeah, that's the type of thing it's all uncertainty. Yeah.
Yeah, I would say that you get a better car, you could probably get a better deal on it. if you know what you're looking for.
I think so, yeah.
More for risk.
Yeah, yeah, I think so. Okay, since that video was so much fun, let's do the other one here too. Some of you have seen this, but
writing's not that easy, but Grammarly can help. This sentence is grammatically correct.
The crisis of rent.
Okay, so some of you have had me before. You've seen this. I've seen this 100 times, and I still like seeing it every time I do. So the housing crisis of 2008. What I want you to be thinking about is how asymmetric information, the little bit that we've touched on so far, kind of works into this. So I'll kind of quiz you afterwards to say, where did you see asymmetric information in the cause of the financial crisis?
Credit crisis. It's a worldwide like financial fiasco involving crimes you've probably heard, like subprime mortgages, collateralized debt obligations, frozen credit markets, and credit default swaps. Who's affected? Everyone. How did it happen? Here's how. The credit crisis brings two groups of people together, homeowners and investors. Homeowners represent their mortgages, and investors represent their money. These mortgages represent houses, and this money represents large institutions like pension funds, insurance companies, sovereign funds, mutual funds, etc. These groups are brought together through the financial system, a bunch of banks and brokers commonly known as Wall Street. While it may not seem like it, these banks on Wall Street are closely connected to these houses on Main Street. To understand how, let's start at the beginning. Years ago, the investors are sitting on their pile of money, looking for a good investment to turn into more money. Traditionally, they go to the U.S. Federal Reserve, where they buy treasury bills, believed to be the safest investment. But in the wake of the dot-com bust in September 11th, Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan lowers interest rates to only 1% to keep the economy strong. 1% is a very low return on investment, so the investors say, no thanks. On the flip side, this means banks on Wall Street can borrow from the Fed for only 1%. Add to that general surpluses from Japan, China, and the Middle East, and there's an abundance of cheap credit. This makes borrowing money easy for banks and causes them to go crazy with leverage. Leverage is borrowing money to amplify the outcome of a deal. Here's how it works. In a normal deal, someone with $10,000 buys a box for $10,000. He then sells it to someone else for $11,000. For a $1,000 profit, a good deal. But using leverage, someone with $10,000 would go borrow $990,000 more, giving him $1 million in hand. Then he goes and buys 100 boxes with his $1 million and sells them to someone else for $1,100,000. Then he pays back his $990,000 plus $10,000 in interest. And after his initial $10,000, he's left with a $90,000 profit versus the other guy's $1,000. Leverage turns good deals into great deals. This is a major way banks make their money. So Wall Street takes out a ton of bread, makes great deals, and grows tremendously rich, and then pays it back. The investors see this and want a piece of the action, and this gives Wall Street an idea. They can connect the investors to the homeowners through mortgages. Here's how it works. A family wants a house, so they save for a down payment and contact a mortgage broker. The mortgage broker connects the family to a lender who gives them a mortgage. The broker makes a nice commission. The family buys a house and becomes homeowners. This is great for them because housing prices have been rising practically forever. Everything works out nicely. One day, the lender gets a call from an investment banker who wants to buy the mortgage. The lender sells it to him for a very nice fee. The investment banker then borrows millions of dollars and buys thousands more mortgages and puts them into a nice little box. This means that every month he gets the payments from the homeowners of all the mortgages in the box. Then he sicks his banker wizards on it to work their financial magic, which is basically cutting it into three slices. Save, okay, and risky. They pack the slices back up in the box and call it a collateralized debt obligation, or CDO. A CDO works like three cascading trays. As money comes in, the top tray fills first, then spills over into the middle, and whatever is left is in the bottom. The money comes from homeowners paying off their mortgages. If some owners don't pay and default on their mortgage, less money comes in, and the bottom tray may not get filled. This makes the bottom tray riskier and the top tray safer. To compensate for the higher risk, the bottom tray receives a higher rate of return, while the top receives a lower, but still nice return. To make the top even safer, banks will insure it for a small fee called a credit default swap. The banks do all of this work so that credit rating agencies will stamp the top slice as a safe AAA rated investment, the highest, safest rating there is. The okay slice is BBB, still pretty good, and they don't bother to rate the risky slice. Because of the AAA rating, the investment banker can sell the safe slice to the investors who only want safe investments. He sells the okay slice to other bankers, and the risky slices to hedge funds and other risk takers. The investment banker makes millions. He then repays his loans. Finally, the investors have found a good investment for their money, much better than the 1% treasury bills. They're so pleased they want more CDO slices. So the investment banker calls up the lender, wanting more mortgages. The lender calls up the broker for more homeowners, but the broker can't find anyone. Everyone that qualifies for a mortgage already has one, but they have an idea. When homeowners default on their mortgage, the lender gets the house, and houses are always increasing in value. Since they're covered if the homeowners default, lenders can start adding risk to new mortgages, not requiring down payments, no proof of income, no documents at all. And that's exactly what they did. So instead of lending to responsible homeowners, called prime mortgages, they started to get some that were, well, less responsible. These are subprime mortgages. This is the turning point. So, just like always, the mortgage broker connects the family with a lender and a mortgage, making his commission. The family buys a big house. The lender sells the mortgage to the investment banker. He turns it into a CDO and sells slices to the investors and others. This actually works out nicely for everyone. It makes them all rich. No one was worried because as soon as they sold the mortgage to the next guy, it was his problem. If the homeowners were in default, they didn't care. They were selling off their risk to the next guy and making millions, like playing hot potato with a time bomb. Not surprisingly, the homeowners default on their mortgage, which at this moment is owned by the banker. This means he forecloses and one of his monthly payments turns into a house. No big deal, he puts it up for sale. But more and more of his monthly payments turn into houses. Now there are so many houses for sale on the market, creating more supply than there is demand, and housing prices aren't rising anymore. In fact, they plummet. This creates an interesting problem for homeowners still paying their mortgages. As all the houses in their neighborhood go up for sale, the value of their house goes down. and they start to wonder why they're paying back their $300,000 mortgage when the house is now worth only $90,000. They decide that it doesn't make sense to continue paying, even though they can afford to, and they walk away from their house. Default rates sweep the country, and prices plummet. Now the investment banker is basically holding a box full of worthless houses. He calls up his buddy, the investor, to sell his CDO, but the investor isn't stupid and says, no thanks. He knows that the stream of money isn't even a dribble anymore. The banker tries to sell to everyone, but nobody wants to buy his bond. He's freaking out because he borrowed millions, sometimes billions of dollars to buy this bond, and he can't pay it back. Whatever he tries, he can't get rid of it. But he's not the only one. The investors have already bought thousands of these bonds. The lender calls up trying to sell his mortgage, but the banker won't buy it, and the broker is out of work. The whole financial system is frozen, and things get dark. Everybody starts going bankrupt. But that's not all. The investor calls up the homeowner and tells him that his investments are worthless. And you can begin to see how the crisis flows in a cycle. Welcome to the crisis of credit.
Okay, questions on that one? Comments before we get into identifying some asymmetric information? Where did you see asymmetric information?
I think one of the most glaring examples was the rate agencies who were rating the doing the CDOs on the credit swaps on the CDOs.
Yeah,
for the CDOs. Because if they're not being even rated right, the further down that the CDO gets passed on from investor to investor, the less they know about the actual risk involved.
Yeah. Yep, so it was hard to kind of get the real value of the houses, and then as the supply went and demand went down, so we got decreasing demand and supply going down, that's price of housing falling, right, and less of a market. And so now those houses started turning the other direction. And then that's kind of what the whole system was based on, that prices were always going up, so it wasn't too big of a deal if it halted. We can get the loser people and give them mortgages, and then they end up causing problems. The rating agency is probably a key one. The Federal Reserve creates some asymmetric information too. So they try to be relatively transparent, but they know what they're going to do to interest rates before the market does, right? So they possess information, the central bank of the United States, that they're going to change interest rates. Before they announce it, they know what they're going to do. That's why people kind of hang on those policies. We got the homeowners who know themselves better than maybe the bankers, the mortgage broker. We have kind of a principal agent problem. So these guys work for these guys in theory, but they talk about passing the hot potato. So these guys got a commission off getting these guys a loan. So we had some information issues there and some incentive problems that were going. Principal agent problem, we talked about it in kind of our last chapter that we're going to cover next week. All kinds of interesting things going on with that financial crisis. Okay, anybody else with last comments or questions before we move on?
Are CDOs still a pretty popular tool in real estate investing?
Yeah, no, they're still used. Yep, they still have that product. They have their purpose, and if the underlying fundamentals are there, they've kind of beefed up, you know, learning through this mess on how to value it better, and they look a lot closer at what's in there.
I mean, it makes sense. You can still do credit swaps, right? Are there new rules for credit rating agencies?
The agencies, no. There's still a little bit of competition among them. But they don't want to be not credible either. So they have incentive to try to get good information. Historically, they've been pretty solid, but there's not a lot of competition with it either. And so, in fact, I just heard a podcast or comment that this is still a key issue they're worried about, because what happens is a company's coming out with a new stock or something, or a new product, or a new share offering, and so they will still try to get the best rating possible for that, because then the pricing's lower, right? They get better interest rates or whatever the case is, and loan or other things. And so that problem still persists out there, and they try to measure whether it's really been better since the financial crisis or not. Some people are arguing that it's not much better. So that could be a problem too. Okay, so let's continue on with our stuff here. This is kind of an interesting case with Zappos, the online shoes. Get that a read. Kind of crazy, huh? Now, why would that be beneficial to Zappos? I mean, to think, given the $2,000, what are they saving on? Us?
They're just reading out people who aren't going to model what they're after. It's just an easy way to get rid of those people without any detrimental way to their reputation.
What else hits the bottom line with those people that don't work out? What do you end up having to do? Where does the company spend money? Training costs, yeah. The training costs, the startup costs. You know, depending on the complexity of your business, sometimes people have a 6-month training period before they really get productive. Like, they're really into the company because they know the things they need to know, right? Other companies, maybe, you know, you go to work for McDonald's and learn how to do fries or something, pretty much a week worth of training and you're good. Watch a few safety videos and you're all set. But in other companies, again, depending on the complexity, it might take a while. And so that can be really costly, especially if you're paying that person $50,000 a year and they take 6 months, that's 25 grand just in salary, right? And if they ultimately aren't productive, then that's kind of a neat way that they tried to offset that. Okay, so a lottery, a random variable with a payment attached to each outcome. So we got different types of people out there. Risk-averse people and risk-neutral people. So what do you think you are? Risk-neutral consumer values a lottery at its expected value. Risk-averse, a little less. Let's see, what all does that mean? So let's... play a game here. So let's see. I've got a $100 bill and a quarter. I think somewhere here. Here's a quarter. A fair quarter. Joshua, Dale, heads. See that? Not like a two-sided coin or anything. So heads, $100, you win, tails, zero. What's the expected payoff? 50? So 50% chance of getting a head, 50% chance of getting a tail with a fair coin on a fair flip. So who wants to play the game? Oh, I see some hands going up, a lot of hands going up. Okay. So, how many of you are willing to pay me $50 to play that game? I'd take an IOU or a check anyway, maybe something. So $50, would you pay me $50 to play that game?
Just one go?
Just one go. We flip this quarter. This $100 bill is right here. So $50, you give me $50, and you might win $100.
But then you really only win 50.
No, I mean, if it's a heads, this thing goes across to your side of the table.
Yeah, but I had to pay $50 just to play.
Right, so how much are you up? You're up 50.
So we're not breaking?
No, because you paid 50, and I'm going to give you this back. So you gave me a $50 bill, I'm going to give you $100 back. So you're up 50, right? Started with a $50 bill, you ended with a $100 bill. So who wants to play?
$50.
Anybody up? $50. You pay 50. So you pay 50, so you'll lose the 50 if you play, right? If it's tail. So 50-50 chance.
I'm just saying, like, are you, like, this is a real situation right now?
Yeah, you got 50 bucks?
You said you take check?
Yeah.
I'm looking at it as the perspective
of a learning experience or something?
No, or someone who's like, I could probably just run off. Like, you know what I mean? Yeah, I just wouldn't pay. If I'm being honest, so I'm not really
paying. So you don't really want to pay. So you want to cheat
like,
me out of the game.
I'm being honest, I'm cheating. Like,
okay. So the answer is no. You're not willing to play the 50 to actually play it. Okay. So how many what would you pay? I want you all to come up with a number of what just keep it to yourself for right now. So I've already identified none of you are willing to pay $50 to play the game, but how much would you pay me to play this game with this bill? Okay? So I'm going to come around the room. I want to hear your numbers. So have your number ready. Does everybody got their number ready? And I think I'll start online since you guys haven't gotten involved as much here. Hopefully, I think you can see the screen better now that the lighting is down, right? Outside? Okay, good. So Jason, how much would you be willing to pay to play that game?
Maybe like $10.
$10, okay. Alex?
Five.
Five, okay. Joshua? 20. 10? 20. 20. 15? 10? 20? 20? 15? 20, okay, so we got a variety of people willing to pay different amounts. So this, first of all, highlights one of our important principles of economics, that everybody has different willingnesses to pay, right? So what you're starting to identify is your level of risk aversion. The fact that none of you were willing to pay 50 means that none of you are risk neutral. None of you are risk neutral. Because the fair price to pay, if you will, is 50 to play that game. But you are like most human beings, you don't want to play that game because you're risk averse, right? You're risk averse. Now, if it was $1.50, I'll play that game, who cares, it'll be fun, right? So that's why I like to pull out the $100 bill and I like to see you like really kind of crap at yourself, like, oh, like really, are we gonna play? Clayton's already trying to figure out how to screw me over on my heart. It's amazing where the mind starts to go with this stuff, right?
This kind of be like gambling at a casino.
Well, yeah, this type of thing is like a gamble. So this
is like how many if you're playing like the dollar slot, how many dollars are you willing, or how many quarters or whatever are you willing to put in there? Because it tells you how much, like the highest that somebody's won on that machine.
Right. You can try to, depending on the slot machine and the information that they disclose, you can try to kind of play that. Some slot machines don't automatically have a fixed payout, some do. So some actually do play the randomness. So it's possible that it will never pay out that. In theory, there's always a probability that it won't. I think that's also due to state regulation sometimes. Any of you guys play pull tabs? Have you heard of pull tabs? Yeah, it's funny, down in Kansas, you almost never see it. Up in Minnesota, that's the big thing. You go to the bar, you're having a beer, you're listening to some tunes, watching football, and there's the pull tab person is selling pull tabs. So pull tabs is basically a paper slot machine. So you get a little card, and you pay a dollar per card, let's say, and then you rip off the little sheet of paper. There's like four different rows to it. You just bend it, you rip it, and then it shows you if you scored like, you know, three pineapples in a row, just like playing a slot machine. So it's called pull tabs. And in Minnesota, it's legal. It's a fundraiser for like, so the little league sports team might be selling pull tabs and you're raising money for the kids' hockey team or something like that. And then they do meat raffles. It's another fun thing in Minnesota. And I thought that was a joke at some point. And then I went up to visit my family and we went bowling and it said meat raffles Sunday. And it's literally a meat raffle. So they've got a bundle of steaks and fresh cut meat. And so let's say it's a $200 value of meat and you pay a dollar and you enter this lottery and you might win the meat. It's called meat raffle. There's all kinds of weird stuff up in the Nordic country there in Minnesota. Okay, so that little piece then is picking up how the insurance markets work. So that difference that you're willing to pay leaves a profitable opportunity for me to make some money because you're willing to pay some money. You're essentially willing to pay, you were at what, $15? 20, you were at 20. So you're willing to kind of have that $30 difference for avoiding the risk. And so that's gonna create a little market for us for risk as we get into the insurance here. Okay, so, let's see, Clayton, just for fun, if you were willing to pay, should we play, see what it comes out?
Yep,
sure. Heads! Hondo would have came your way, would have been up 50. Okay, well, that's the laser cookie. Has anyone ever played it? Nope. Not at this point.
That GA pension, man.
Yeah, I was trying to think when the check hits, too, if I can justify it. Alright, so here's our insurance example. So we got Rachel has a bicycle valued at $100. So her bike is $100. If it gets stolen, she loses it, and zero if it's not, right? So if the bike doesn't get stolen, she doesn't lose anything. Suppose the probability of theft is 20%, then the expected cost is 20, right? So Rachel's taking on an expected cost of 20. This is where it gets a little bit weird, but there's a chance of theft and she's absorbing that cost. So she has an expected cost of 20. Suppose that State Farm will reimburse her for the bike if she pays them 25. Did she eliminate the risk?
I don't know about eliminate the risk, she's covered.
So identify the risk here then. What is the risk? Theft. And how much? 20%. Did she eliminate it by paying the 25? Did she eliminate that risk? Yes, because she'll get a $100 bike back, right? So she bought safety, if you will. She took away that risk. That risk is gone now. She's always going to have a bike worth $100. By paying 25, okay? So we kind of got to twist our brains around a little bit and think about what she's buying and selling. Now, State Farm is gonna earn $5. So this gets into the risk aversion part. So State Farm's willing to play that game and be risk neutral. So on average, she quits worrying about the bike and the insurance company gets $25 each year, so she doesn't have to face the risk. What is the insurance company going to make? It depends on what happens, right? What are they going to make on average?
Would not be $25 per year?
That's what they're going to collect in premiums, but in terms of profit,
oh,
if they have 1,000 Rachels, how much are they going to make?
$5.
They're capitalizing on Rachel's risk aversion, right? So they're going to make average, the expected cost is 20, and Rachel's paying 25. So there's going to be some bikes that are stolen, and they're going to have to make the payout. So on a large pool of people, on average, they should be making $5 per person by making that deal.
Bank on way more people not having their bikes stolen than actually stolen.
Well,
everybody got their bike stolen.
Yeah, and that comes down to they want to have a pretty good assessment of what the probability is. We'll kind of get in. We're going to explore that as we build onto this example. Okay, so we can kind of think about the expected loss, 20% chance of 25, and 80% chance of 25 gives us the $5 premium. There's our probability statement, right? P times X1 plus P, to, 1 minus P times X2. Same formula that we've been working on this evening. Okay, so suppose there's two bike groups with equal people, like Rachel, willing to pay the expected loss plus 5. So that's kind of their little formula that they have for risk aversion. Expected loss plus 5 is their willingness to pay. So we got two groups. One is in the bad part of town. One is in the good part of town. In the good part of town, 20% chance of death. In the bad part of town, 40% chance of death. What is the expected average cost of claims for State Farm if both groups are insured with them? What is the expected average cost? So we know Rachel's 20% chance of $100 bike is the 20, and what's it for the bad part of town? 40. So on average, if there's equal groups, what would it be across the board for the whole pool? You're adding them. You wouldn't add them. 30. Right. So we'd have an average loss of 30. Okay. So we're just averaging those two pieces together. All right, so we would be pricing it at what to make money at State Farm? If our average across the two pools is 35, right? So we offer $35 premium. Now, right. So we're just trying to, we're just kind of looking at this in general, looking at the whole pool of people, and hey, on average, the averages work out to be 35. Now, when we offer 35, who buys the policy? It's still capitalism. Nobody's forced like Obamacare to have to buy insurance or anything. People who are risk averse, not an elephant in the sheath, but what if people who are risk averse? In general, we have the risk-averse people, because what they said, people are willing to pay expected loss plus 5. So what's Rachel, go ahead.
Group 2 would definitely buy.
Group 2 is going to definitely buy. What about group 1? It's too high, right? Remember, their preference is to say, I'll take my expected loss, and I'm willing to pay $5 more. I'm willing to pay, in group 1's case, 25, but not 45. So now, when State Farm offers the policy at 35, who comes knocking at their door? I'm looking for some insurance. I heard you got a policy. Who comes?
The ones more likely to get their bike stolen.
The group two people. Do any of the group ones come? No, that's adverse selection. So what happened is we've adversely attracted the wrong group of people. Because of the way we did this setup, we kind of made a mistake here, basically, by averaging out the losses and treating the whole pool. By doing it that way, we're only going to attract the high-risk people. And so when I attract the high-risk people, am I going to be making money? If I sell them a $35 premium and I have losses of 40, no. I'm gonna lose $5 on every person. So this could be a very costly mistake that the insurance company could make by not recognizing adverse selection.
So you wouldn't even get the 20% of people who have actually, who live in a good neighborhood, who actually have had their rights stolen?
So we're not looking at it like whether people have gotten their bike stolen or not. So we just have two groups of people, and these are the probabilities of theft in, for each group.
Okay.
And they're just equal populations. Again, this is just kind of a little model to get us thinking through it. But this would say we don't want to pool people together, right? So you guys can probably see where this is going. It's like if you live in the bad neighborhood, you need to pay a higher rate than the people in the good neighborhood.
Yeah, I'm gonna be getting a steal basically for going to the third spot, right?
Yeah. And so that's where you could get it, and this happens, of course, and if you're in a big city where there's lots of theft and you try to get a policy, it's gonna be more expensive in that city than it would be in Ottawa, Kansas or something, right? So that type of thing certainly goes on. We can't discriminate based on the protected classes, right? So that wouldn't be legal in the United States, even if the data shows that Catholics have a higher percentage of theft than Lutherans or something, right? So even if the data shows that, we can't use that as a discrimination mechanism to say, you guys gotta pay this and you guys gotta pay this. But based on other things, you can't. And so the reason I bring that up, there's kind of a famous case that outlawed what's called redlining. And so in real estate, bankers would say, this is the bad part of town. We only make loans to people who live here. And so there was a red line that outlined, we're not going to loan to people here. Even though those people might be creditworthy, and just because they live in a bad neighborhood doesn't mean they wouldn't pay back their mortgage, right? We're not kind of outside of the chance of theft thing here. But maybe data would show on average that people pay their loans off better here, but that doesn't mean really that a person here would be equally able to pay off a loan. So this was a practice that was made illegal, for example, that's more in the house lending market.
That's why it's more on like an individual basis.
Individual basis, yeah. So you go for an insurance policy, all the things you guys said with taking your blood pressure and doing all that stuff is the way that they look at it. It's all on an individual basis. Okay, so so then this just kind of motivates our screening thing that we talked about, that if we can somehow screen these people, we can charge different rates to different people. If we can't set up a successful screen, then State Farm has to charge $45, right? And then that's just, maybe there'll be a few, you know, Rachels out there that are that risk averse. Like, who said $5 to play that game? A couple people, Alex had $5. Right? So she had a bigger risk aversion than Joshua, who said 20, right? So there was $15 on the table. Maybe Alex would still buy the $45 policy because that's her particular preference structure. She's willing to pay more to make sure that her bike's going to be safe, right? So that's still possible that we would get that as we look at that. Otherwise, we might be able to separate out the people in a more efficient way. Okay, so one technique is to use partial insurance. So would the low-risk customer pay $15 if she gets $50 when the bike is stolen? Not $100, but $50. So instead of full insurance, she's going to have kind of partial insurance. She's partially paying, and the insurance company's partially paying. Would this possibly make sense for Rachel? Yeah. What's the 20% chance now? What's the loss here with $10? Our little formula was $10 plus 5 is 15. So Rachel might be willing to do that. And so how does this happen in the car market? You guys are thinking about car insurance liability. What's your closest thing here for car insurance? Not liability. What do you got to pay if you get into a wreck?
Deductible.
That's this. If you raise your deductible, what happens to your premium? Your premium's your monthly payment, right? If you raise your deductible, your premium goes down. That's why. You are insuring yourself, essentially, by having a higher deductible, right? You're partially insuring yourself because you're paying that deductible if you're correct. Okay, questions or comments there? All right, so in the car market, Drew, you kind of brought this up. I don't know if you remember from a different class, but were you thinking of the lemons problem? I'm curious when you're hitting right on an issue. Yeah. So this is adverse selection also. Any questions about the problem? So we got cherries and lemons, 2,000 and 4,000. So on a random draw, you have an expected value of 3. I might have a 50% chance of getting a lemon, I got a 50% chance of getting a cherry, right? So my expected value is 3,000, but if I do 3,000, I'm not going to get it. So what do you think is the best strategy here for your buyer if you're in that situation? What do you offer?
Offer the 2, maybe pay the 50,000.
And you got what you paid for though, right? So you didn't get screwed. So that's the problem with the lemons market, is that we have an inefficient price and not a good quantity of cars being exchanged because everybody has to factor in the fact that they might get screwed. So a person with a good car, a cherry, can't get it sold because the best strategy really is to offer that, because at least you'll know you're getting the car that you thought you were going to. Of course, with cars, then we can start to learn about the car and car warranties and all kinds of that stuff. We got the screens and the guarantees, and when we go buy it on Craigslist, we can go take it to a mechanic and have them do a $120 check of the car and check out everything. Of course, is that foolproof? No, but maybe hopefully you're hitting some of the basics. So that's how those markets evolve. Again, all of that stuff is to try to equalize the information. So incentive pay. Hard workers and lazy workers. Why does a straight salary lead to adverse selection?
People who work way more than they're supposed to still make the same fair minimum or any money.
Okay. And so when I offer a straight salary, who do I attract? The lazy ones, right? So that's our adverse selection that we gotta be careful of. So how could I defeat that? Well, how could I maybe overcome the adverse selection problem? Incentives, like what?
Commission.
Right, so instead of a straight salary, we're going to lower maybe a base salary or make it 100% commission, right? And so then it's kind of a feast or famine on the pay. Let me go back to this for a second. How could this hurt us possibly with base salary? Like, are we always going to get the right person if we go to straight 100% commission? No. So what? How do you find the right level of base pay versus commission as you're starting to kind of factor that out?
Well, then we kind of be on bid. Like, I know I'm base pay salary and commission at my job. And, like, if I don't do anything, I know I'm not.
What job?
I work at T-Mobile.
T-Mobile, okay.
So I know that, like, if I just show up to work, like, I'm going to make a certain amount. But if I show up to work and actually, like, sell phones, sell accessories, all of that, I know that I'm I have a higher chance of getting a better commission check.
What is your base, if you look at your commission versus your base pay, what ends up being bigger over the course of a year, is a higher fraction of your pay commission base or base pay? Like, is it 75% base pay and 25% commission, or is it, and you flipped around, where it's mostly commission and a little bit of base pay?
I think it's mostly commission.
Mostly commission?
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay. That's the issue I'm trying to think about, is like, well, what might we be missing out on, you know, if we go 100% commission, let's say, and no base pay, you know, would people be attracted to that, or would we miss out on some people? You know, that sort of thing. About Wes, what do you think?
So, to find the same thing, one of my buddies graduated a couple of years ago, got a job, and he was starting off at like $20 an hour or something, and he was working tons of overtime. And after a couple of years of this, they realized, like, hey, we need to put him on salary because we could pay him $45 a year or whatever rather than paying him $25 an hour plus a time and a half overtime because he worked so much hours. So, he's making way more in the hourly.
Yeah.
And it was killing the company.
That is different. That is different. So that is different because we're not struggling with the same thing of how productive the people are. You've got kind of it's kind of sounds similar because you got the overtime motivation. But usually places will limit the amount of overtime. So they'll just say you can't put in more than X amount of overtime. You got to clock out and we'll find a new worker. That means we're understaffed, right? If you're putting in that many hours, then we need to find somebody else.
Would it be like 100% commission base? Who would like to pay, say, don't like 100% commission?
Yeah.
Because, like, with me, I had a choice of playing pro golf or going to the golf business. Well, going to the golf business, I have a salary base. In pro golf, only if I pay well, I get money.
Right.
So,
yep.
I paid it.
So we might miss out on somebody who that's like just too risky for them. They have a family, they have a baby to feed, they have whatever, some sort of obligation. It's like, so we might be able to get it. We might be missing out on a really good person that is still going to be really good, and enough of a carrot for the commission is just like 50-50 or something, or whatever the breakdown is. So that's the fear, that it's not easy to just say, oh, let's just make it 100% commission, because then we might be overlooking some good people.
I was going to say, I know for me personally, because I get commissioned, that it can kind of incentivize me to be lazier in a way, because if there's someone who I know is going to be a really hard sell, I'll just kind of try to find someone who's easy.
But you're still looking for the next sale.
Yeah, but I'm just saying that, like, it makes it easier.
We talked a little bit about the tipping today, kind of that sort of thing. So, yeah. The owner, depending on the situation, that might be okay if we don't have that person, if they were going to be difficult. But maybe in some cases, like the restaurant did today with the tipping, they want that person in the seat. They're
right.
Still, you know, paying for the base meal. Okay, so we talked about signaling earlier. So people revealing information between that whoever has the information revealing it. So a screen can also be used as a signal. So low-risk consumers could offer to buy insurance with a big deductible. So that way, we're kind of self-selecting into that with the deductible option that we talked about before. So advertising, I've kind of come to learn, I mean, I used to kind of fall for that before a little bit, but like, oh, if they're advertising for the Super Bowl, they must be high quality, right? That type of thing. But again, that can just be a signal. And so ultimately, you better have a good product. So we mentioned eBay with the ratings for adverse selection. This is kind of a nice little case study too. What do you think? Too harsh? Is that fair? 24 unpaid classroom hours over 8 days in a 4-week period, unpaid. If candidate is tardy, he or she is sent home and not allowed to return.
Really beats up people who are always sending on that call.
Yeah. And if they get warned that that's the policy ahead of time, you know, shouldn't that help? So maybe some policies that sound kind of harsh, maybe it sets the expectations, and here's what they found out. So pretty successful. They were able to kind of weed that out by having what maybe saying, oh, that's unfair, it's just late, because I had a flat tire or whatever.